I will call the City of Dacono Monday, November 28th, 2022 regular City Council meeting to order. Can I get a roll call, please, Val?
Danny Long.
Doris
Crespo.
Here.
Catherine Whitman.
Here.
Jim Tarini.
Here.
Jackie Thomas.
Here.
Kevin Plain.
Here.
Adam Moorhead.
I am here. Can you please all stand for the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I see no presentations and proclamations, so now is the time for any public comment on issues not scheduled on the agenda. Before we get into any comment, I just wanted to bring something to everybody's attention. As a friendly reminder, the public comment portion of our agenda is for council to hear comments. Questions may be asked by council for clarification, and staff may be asked to follow up with you if needed. Do not yell at council from the back of the room. Use the public comment period and public hearing period during general business and speak on the record from the podium. Do not disrupt the meeting with conversations inside council chambers. Do not attempt to harass applicants after they leave council chambers. As presiding officer of the meeting, I'm responsible for ensuring the meeting is decorum is courteous and professional. And thank you for hearing me on that. So, come on up.
Good evening, honorable council members. So I have a quick question. I think I have a couple other questions, but I'll be able to make public comment on the budget. Is that correct? When that budget comes up?
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. And then the other one will be on 801 Flying Circle, which we'll be discussing a little later as well. Correct?
Correct.
Perfect. Okay, great. So I'm just curious as to why the agenda is posted. Is it usually Friday before a meeting, Val? So I guess I'm just curious as to why it isn't posted a little sooner for two reasons. Number one, so that your residents, that your citizens that live here, work here, play here, can take a look at it prior, right? Like a couple days prior, instead of a weekend with kids and the busyness. It would be really helpful as a resident so that I know, hey, I need to set aside time for myself in my busy week so that I can attend this meeting or address these issues or, gosh, you know, what's going on doesn't pertain initially to me. And then as citizens, if we don't take the initiative to show up at that time, then that's on us. But to have a little bit more time in order to look at the agenda and to review it and decide if we're going to show up would be really helpful. And council members, I think it would be helpful for you as well. I mean, you all, this is not your full-time job. Right? You all work outside of this. You have families. You have other commitments. So I think it would be helpful for you all as well to have access to the agenda prior. And maybe they do, Val? Do they get it on Friday as well?
It's always available.
Okay. Okay. So I'm just, my question is, why is it not available a week prior for your residents and for the council members? I would respectfully request that agendas be posted a week prior to the meetings. This would show residents your willingness to be transparent and involve the people that are impacted by the decisions being made here. Thank you.
Thank you. Before you leave today, can you give AJ your contact information and let him follow up with you about this?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Any other public comment on matters not on the agenda? Hearing and seeing none, it's time for swearing in of our new council member, one of them.
Please raise your right hand. I,
Kevin Plain,
do swear or affirm that I will support the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of the State of Colorado, the laws of the State of Colorado, the Dacono Ordinances and Commonwealth Charter, and will faithfully perform the duties of the office of City Council upon which I'm about to enter to the best of my ability.
I do.
Thank you. And Kevin, I appreciate your service to the city. as well as Planning Commission and other things you do for the city, and it's greatly appreciated.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you for stepping up again. Okay. Excuse me. Next is a consent agenda. The following items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine business matters by the council that can be decided without discussion and will be enacted with a single motion and a single vote. Any council member may request removal of any item they do not want to consider without discussion or wish to vote no on, without jeopardizing the approval of other items on the consent agenda. Items removed will be placed under the general business category in the order they appear on the agenda. We have A, minutes of the November 14th, 2022 regular meeting. Excuse me. B, accounts payable dated November 28th, 2022 in the amount of $144,227.65. And C, approval of resolution 2290, approving an agreement for deputy municipal judge services. Do I have a motion?
Move to approve the consent agenda as read.
I'll second.
Thank you. Can I get a vote, please, Val?
Katherine Whitman?
Yes.
Jim Tirini?
Yes.
Jackie Thomas?
Yes.
Kevin Plain?
Yes.
Doris Crespo?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Up next is the public hearing for Community Development Block Grant Application. So at this time, the first several items of general business are public hearings, the purpose of which are to receive evidence regarding the matter before the City Council and provide a public forum for all interested persons who wish to comment on these matters. The general procedure for the public hearing will be as follows. For those items that are not land use matters, we will have presentations by city staff. For land use items, we will have a presentation by the applicant, followed by a presentation by city staff. After these presentations for each agenda item, members of the public may provide comments up to 4 minutes. Any questions raised during public comment will be noted, and after receiving all public comments, the applicant and city staff will each have an opportunity to respond to any questions or comments. The City Council does not answer questions during public hearings. Rather, the City Council's role is to receive evidence and make a decision on the matter before it. Council members may ask questions of anyone who testifies. We generally ask our questions after each person has testified. We generally don't ask questions during the presentations. At the conclusion of the testimony for the public hearing, I will close the public hearing and no further testimony or other evidence will be received. The City Council will discuss the matter and take some kind of action. Public hearings are recorded for the public record. All testimony must be presented after stating your full name and address, and the city clerk swears you in. Does anyone participating in these hearings object to the procedure I've described? Seeing none, this time I'll ask each council member whether they have any disclosures regarding the public hearings, such as conflicts of interest or any ex parte communication. Do I need to read these names? I don't think so, do I?
That is the intent.
Okay. Doris? Crespo? Do you have any conflicts or ex parte communications? Okay. Danny Long, not here. Kevin Plain?
No.
Jackie Thomas?
No.
Jim Tirini?
No.
Catherine Whitman?
No.
And for the public hearing record, I will state that I do not have any disclosures to make regarding this hearing myself either. So up for general business item A, I will now open the public hearing for the Community Development Block Grant Application, and that'll be a city staff presentation. So Jen, you're up.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This is a public hearing for the city's application for fiscal year 2022 and 2023 community development block grant applications. This public hearing is a highly recommended step set forth by Weld County for agencies that do intend to submit applications for community development block grant or CDBG funding. The intent of this public hearing this evening is to serve as an opportunity for Dacono citizens, public agencies, or other interested parties to provide any testimony or public comments regarding the needs of low to moderate income persons in the city of Dacono, any comments on any housing or community development needs or any other needs in Dacono that they feel are important. CDBG funds are federal funds that are intended to benefit low to moderate income residents through the rehabilitation and preservation of housing, economic or job development, and public facility improvements. As I indicated, the City of Dacono does intend to make two applications for funding. The first application is for water system improvements on Glendale Street. There were some fiscal year 2022 funds that were returned to Weld County. Another agency was not able to fulfill its obligations, and therefore there's about $310,000 of funding. We have a shovel-ready project, and the city does intend to submit an application for the full $310,000. The 2023 application will be for road improvements on Glen Heather Street. That is part of the competitive 2023 funding cycle. The county has a little bit over $1 million available, and the city is going to request approximately $350,000 towards that project. Both of these projects will benefit low to moderate household incomes, 56% in both project areas. We do not intend to see the involuntary displacement of any residents or businesses with these applications. And no action is necessary by City Council, but certainly if there are public comments, now would be the time to accept those.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any public comment regarding the block grant? Hearing none, thank you, Jen, for your presentation. And no action needs to be taken by the council. So we will move on to the next agenda item. I'll now open the public hearing on Ordinance 934, rezoning a certain property known as 801 Flying Circle Boulevard on second reading. We will have the applicant presentation. Oh, I had applicant. Oh, I see you had the... Okay, right.
Hi. No problem.
Please raise your right hand. State your name and address.
Chris Lee, 209 East 4th Street, Loveland, Colorado. Hi, Council. Hope you all had a good Thanksgiving. We were here a couple of weeks ago for our first reading. As you guys remember, hopefully you remember, we are trying to subdivide and rezone the 801 property, 801 Flying Circle property. Right now it's one larger lot, just under 3 acres. We're trying to subdivide it into two smaller lots, one just over 3/4 acre and another one just under 1.5 acres. And we're also in the midst of doing that, trying to rezone the property. The biggest thing for rezoning is to simplify what we can put on the property and sort of limit what we can put on the property. Currently, it's a C1 zone, which allows all sorts of stuff, including high-density residential, automotive-based uses, and we're trying to limit those uses to smaller buildings, smaller uses, things that are more centric towards the neighborhood that it abuts. So that's kind of the overall view there. Again, we're trying to get personal services, doctor's offices, small restaurants, things that are not, again, heavy vehicle use. And so we're going to eliminate that use so that use will not be allowed in the future. And then also we're trying to eliminate, or we will eliminate, any residential use in there that comes to hotels, apartments, anything high density like that. Currently, I think we're allowed to build up to 10 stories tall, roughly 100 feet. We're going to limit that to 25 feet tall, do a single story building, and again, try to keep things personal service type uses that we can help integrate into the neighborhood adjacent to the space.
Any questions? Any questions from council? We usually wait until after the city, but okay. We'll see. So, Mark, are you up?
Thank you, Mayor. Members of City Council, good evening. Mark Dorian with the City of Dacono. At this time, I'd like to enter into the record the staff report, the zoning ordinance, and the comprehensive plan. We're here tonight to talk about 801 Flying Circle rezoning from C1 to PUD. So the PD process, there's several steps that are involved. Tonight, we're here for the second reading of the PUD. The first reading was with the preliminary development plan 2 weeks ago. For those not familiar on the site, it's shown here on the screen in blue. They are proposing to rezone it from C1 to planned unit development, or PUD. Kind of give a refresher for you folks. That is the site. North is now to your right. There is an existing building on the site shown there in red. That's the former TBK Bank. It was a modular building that is proposed to be removed from the site and replaced with another building, as well as additional buildings that would go on the site. That orange line is the current sidewalk that is installed that stops just north of the access into the bank site. So on the screen here before you is the current site. They are proposing with the PUD to split it into two when they do a subdivision and to build two new buildings. The red one will replace where the bank was. The blue one will be a new building that faces Highway 52. And there will be a sidewalk that goes up to Highway 52 and to the west on top of the screen. And then there will be restriping done for Flying Circle for left turn lanes into the site and to take a left onto Highway 52. C1 has a multitude of uses. I've highlighted a couple of the special uses that include gas stations, motor vehicle sales and servicing, motor fueling stations and garages. Additionally, the C1 does allow for a maximum height of 100 feet. As proposed with the planned unit development, prohibited uses would be drive-throughs, gas stations and garages, and motor vehicle sales and servicing. And again, the height is limited to 25 feet with this application. There are a bunch of standards on this screen that's in the staff report, but I highlighted at the very bottom the 27 spaces on the southern lot and the 63 spaces on the northern lot. So there will be a grand total of 90 parking spaces as proposed with this development. So in our code, we look at the criteria for zoning and rezoning decisions. We look to make sure that the request is in the public interest and that the public interest is best served by granting the application for rezoning. Additionally, we want to make sure that it meets the goals and policies of the comprehensive plan and other policies in the city. And then we also look at it with regards to state statutes, so making sure that it's safe, protecting health, safety, welfare, and providing for appropriate new development. And then lastly, has there been a change in the neighborhood community or mistake in the zone district? There has been a change, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. So our analysis that we performed, the proposed zoning does limit high traffic commercial uses such as garages and drive-through restaurants. It also limits the height of the commercial buildings to 25 feet instead of 100 under the C1 zone district. It is consistent with goals and policies of the comprehensive plan. It allows for a neighborhood retail center to provide goods and services for the surrounding neighborhood and reduces impacts of more higher intensity commercial development that generate more traffic. It also reduces congestion, provides for pedestrian bicycle connections to and from the existing neighborhood and to State Highway 52. And the proposed zoning will allow for redevelopment of a vacant commercial site and will allow for an additional building of commercial development on the north end of the current site. So with that, I open up to any questions that you may have of staff.
I only have one. Anything changed since the first reading?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions, anybody? Okay.
I did have one question mark. Sorry. You said there was a change and you were going to cover it later. What?
Oh, I'm sorry. The character of the neighborhood has changed since it was originally done. That bank site, when it was built back in 2004, that was planned to have a second building when they did granted the approval back in 2006. And that building never got built. And in 2019, the city revoked that site plan for that modular building. So the neighborhood has grown more since 2006. And it's never gotten that connection over to Highway 52 or to the west.
Okay. So that was a modular that was...
It is a modular building currently.
Okay.
Any other questions? Thanks.
Any public comment on Ordinance 934?
Marion Thompson, 445 House Court, Dacono, 80514. Thank you. All right, hello again. All right, I would ask the following of the City Council members regarding 801 Flying Circle. With the other paving of roads in Dacono, with the paving of the other roads in Dacono, why is finishing the 6th Street stub not being done? Because I do know that there's other paving going on. So just something to consider. There are multiple ways to get this done, so I'm not just coming complaining. I'm offering up some other solutions. Developers could come and pay a proportional share. So option one, have developers come and pay their proportional share. This is going to be developed. 801 is going to be developed across the street, right to the east is going to be developed. And so a proportional share could be distributed between both of those developers or whatever that looks like, right? If there's five developers in their total, I don't know exactly what that looks like in terms of development, but let there be a proportional share. Let each one of those developers contribute their proportional share to have that done. 801 Flying Circle, the development of that is going to impact traffic flow in and out of Sharp Farms. It just is. You're adding businesses, you're adding more traffic, you're bringing more traffic. And I want to say that we are thrilled. The residents of Sharp Farms are thrilled that we're going to have some commercial, as Mr. Lee stated, what did he say? Personal uses. It's wonderful. We're super excited. So we welcome this commercial development. But it is going to also impact traffic flow, right? That's going to be more, there's going to be more traffic in the circle, more traffic coming in and out of our neighborhood. So the proportional share would be an option. We would ask that, you know, you uphold the standard that if developers do come into Dacono, that they will have to help pave the way regardless of where it is. So you would be helping to set the standard for future development in all of Dacono. This is what we expect of our developers. If you want to come develop here, then you're going to need to pay a proportional share. You could also do a reimbursement agreement. City of Dacono could fund it or initially fund it and then be reimbursed, or developers could fund it initially and then be reimbursed again with that proportional share. So I would just ask that you really consider completing that 6th Street stub for the residents of Sharp Farms now and in the future. And even for those that are going to be using that commercial site, more entrance and exit access for them. It would also really help with some of the congestion that happens at 52 and Colorado. If people could reroute south of that intersection, as you all know, if you travel that at all, it can get pretty congested, especially during high traffic times. So having just another exit out of Sharp Farms that could divert away from that intersection would help to alleviate some of that. And for the safety of the residents, having more access for emergency vehicles is really important to us. So I would ask that you would consider that. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you have any questions for the city or the applicant in this case, though? Or is it just more of some comments on that stuff, on that 6th Street?
No, specifically, I do not.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I can only comment on this in generalities, but council and I did discuss that issue, and we're hoping to come up with a solution somehow in the near future. We discussed several things, so can't really comment on them because they're ideas. They're not concrete yet, but we're conscious of that and looking at that. You're welcome. Sure. Any questions from council? Okay. Hearing that, I will close the public hearing on ordinance 934. And are there any council deliberations? And if not, I will take a motion.
I'll approve ordinance 934, rezoning a certain property known as 801 Flying Circle Boulevard on second reading.
Second.
Can I get a vote, please, Belle?
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Catherine Whitman.
Yes.
Jim Tarini.
Yes.
Jackie Thomas.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Ordinance 934 passes with all council voting yes. Next item on the agenda is general business item C. I will now open the public hearing on ordinance 935, amending chapter 13 of the Dacono Municipal Code regarding municipal water service on second reading.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This is the second reading for your consideration of Ordinance 935, which is an ordinance amending Chapter 13 of the Dacono Municipal Code regarding municipal water service. I am not Pete Johnson. He was here last week and gave you a very comprehensive overview of this particular ordinance. A couple of key issues that I do want to address is that this ordinance does not include any kind of a rate increase. This ordinance kind of resets our water ordinance, addresses and clarifies some water tap and water meter issues. It creates specific requirements regarding construction water and hydrant meters. It addresses violations of our water, I mean, our municipal water ordinance, includes specific standards regarding the transfer of water taps, and it does include two new sections regarding non-potable irrigation and raw water dedication also. But again, it does not include a water rate increase. As you know, there is an ongoing water rate study, and staff will come back at a later time to the council regarding any changes in water rates. There were not any changes between the first and second reading of Ordinance 935, and staff does recommend approval.
Thank you, Jen. Any public comment regarding Ordinance 935? Hearing none. Any questions for the city from council members? Hearing none, I'll now close the public hearing on Ordinance 935. Any council deliberations? If not, I will take a motion.
Move to approve Ordinance 935, amending Chapter 13 of the Dacono Municipal Code regarding municipal water service on second reading.
I'll second.
Thank you, please, Belle.
Catherine Whitman.
Yes.
Jim Tarini.
Yes.
Jackie Thomas.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Ordinance 935 passes with all council voting yes. We'll now go move on to general business item D. And I will open the public hearing on the 2020. Oh, hang on a second. We done C yet? Yeah, we did. Water.
That's one I just
did. We are. They are on to D. Okay. Open the public hearing on the 2023 budget and city staff, please. Welcome.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Let me get established, set up here. Sorry, first time using this setup. Trying to figure out a full screen method here. Okay. All right. Here we are. Much better. And you'll have to excuse my voice. It might crackle a little bit during this presentation, so bear with me.
Perfectly.
Fielder.
So this is the public hearing for the 2023 budget and approval of three different resolutions for the budget. Enclosed in the packet and for the record is the final 2023 budget for the city. Citizens are welcome to provide input on the city's budget at any time. Colorado law requires that a specific date be set for public hearing on the proposed annual budget before its formal adoption. Adoption of the budget and certification of the mill levy must be accomplished before December 15th. The public hearing for the 2023 proposed budget was set by City Council for November 28th, 2022, and notice was properly published in the Times Call. Since then, the city has received two Colorado Open Records Act requests for work session documents and the budget itself. The city uses the platform known as ClearGov to develop and publish the yearly budget. And it's a web-based program, and it's designed to provide budget transparency to the public with a user-friendly platform. The public will have the opportunity to scroll the budget once it is approved by council, and all of the resolutions have been signed, collected, and added to the budget, and also the certification of the mill levy performed, which won't happen until after the next council meeting once we have the final assessed values from Weld County. So we will have a link provided on our website for anybody from the public to view the budget in its entirety. So just to go over some of what we have been working on and discussing in the various work sessions and staff meetings leading up to this day. So there is a brief economic outlook presented by the governor of the state, which states Colorado job growth is expected to remain strong in 2022, exceeding 2021 growth. Job growth slows in the out years, but continues to outpace the nation because the local economy has a higher concentration of service sectors that are expected to fare better over the forecast period. The primary Colorado inflation rate is expected to face additional upward pressure from shelter and service prices relative to the nation as a whole. Real retail sales growth remains positive in 2022 at a pace slightly higher than the U.S., but then similar to the country as a whole, turns negative in 2023 in the face of rising inflation. As a state, Colorado has continued outpaced other states, showing a strong economic performance with a 3.4% unemployment rate and second in the country for job participation rate. So the city anticipates that economic conditions in Colorado will remain relatively flat for 2022 or for 2023, similar to 2022. We have high inflation and strong job growth and low unemployment in Colorado, but what that brings is high interest rates and higher housing prices and an employment market that continues to be extremely competitive. So based on some of those economic assumptions and some of the preliminary information received, currently assessed values are up 24.7%, generating $3.18 million in property tax revenue. And the mill levy is currently set at 22.46 and will continue to be so. And that will also create some street fund property tax as well, but we will discuss that in a little bit here. New housing starts will remain pretty stable to what they are this year, 60 to 100, depending on growth in certain neighborhoods. Sweetgrass, Eagle Meadow continue to build, and hopefully we'll have Mesa Ridge coming sometime and able to pull some permits in 2023. Sales tax is expected to increase a modest 3% from 22 projected collections, but that's actually 20% above the original budgeted projections. So sales tax is actually doing quite well. It keeps outperforming itself year after year. Online revenue continues to just add more and more revenue. So it's definitely beneficial for the city, and it remains the second largest tax revenue collector in the general fund. Also, with the new housing starts, use tax revenue will come in from those new home permits. Total general tax fund collections make up 91.5% of all revenue in the general fund, which is $5.3 million. So it's a significant portion of the revenue for the general fund. Street fund property tax is based off of the mill levy that is set for the payment of the GO bond, which is the bond that we have 3 years left to pay on out in the Glens. So that will be based on whatever those final assessed values come back at, but it will only be enough to generate $215,650 for that bond payment. Other street revenues are, of course, sales and use tax, which shares its revenue with the general fund and the capital fund as well. And we also have the CDOT Highway User Tax Fund, generating fees from car registrations, fuel sales, and other vehicle fees. We also get county road and bridge fees from Weld County, and tax generates 97% of all street fund revenues. In the water fund enterprise, our revenue is reliant upon fees that are charged for services. 95.4% of all water fund revenues come from water sales. The 2023 projections are set to increase based on the results of the rate study, which hasn't started yet. So once we get those in, we will probably be modifying those rates next year. Current base water sales of $2.2 million just isn't enough to sustain long-term operation of water system with the rising vendor costs and research and development costs that are associated with the water fund. 2023 projections include cash in lieu contracts totaling approximately $9.6 million. They're one-time cash contracts, and the funds generated from those contracts are there to provide additional water and infrastructure, and they're not for operating costs. In the capital fund, the regular sources of revenue are sales and use tax, which is 10% of total collected, and interest income from investments. We are anticipating receiving an $800,000 CDOT grant, which will be used to fund a capital project for 2023. And $4 million also will be transferred from general and street funds to support other capital projects and assets being purchased. And $1.7 million will be reimbursed by the Urban Renewal Authority of Dacono, which is a component unit of the City of Dacono, and will be funding another project. The remaining two funds are the special revenue funds of the Conservation Trust Fund, which receives lottery proceeds, and they are restricted use proceeds for parks and recreational amenities. And the impact fee revenue from development fees collected on building permits. Those are also restricted use, and they're used to expand capacity or use due to development. And they're only for capital improvements. And this year, we anticipate half of those fees in the impact fee fund will come from impact fees. The other half will be a transfer in of American Rescue Plan Act funds to support yet another capital project. So just to kind of go over the fund summaries for each of the funds, we have a 2023 beginning fund balance approximately 2.0 5.4 million revenue, additional revenue being 6.8 million, and total expenses of 6.6 million, which are then divided up between the five sections that you see on the screen. And then there will be a revenue transfer of just over 1 million for capital projects to the capital fund for an ending fund balance of 4.5 million. And that is 59% of the current year's spending budget. So it's still a very healthy fund balance. These are the projects that are going to be supported by the general fund: a bi-directional antenna, server replacement, which is also shared with the water and street funds, fiber optic cable run from City Hall to Public Works, and then the following debt appropriations: COP 2020 bond series payment of $408,000, another COP 2021 bond series payment for $295,000, Axon cameras for the police department in both body worn and fleet variety of $33,450, and enterprise lease payments approximately $90,000. And those are for the police Tahoe vehicles. In the water fund, we have a beginning fund balance of nearly $4.8 million. That revenue generated almost $12.4 million, majority of that coming from those cash and lieu contracts, and expenditures of $5.6 million as itemized to follow, with a fund balance of $11.5 million. And the water fund capital projects are, again, the server replacement, new SCADA system, water tower painting, and the Glendale water line replacement, which is a carryover from this year. Debt appropriations are from the enterprise lease payments for various public works trucks that are also shared with the street fund, and the 2014 series water revenue bonds of approximately $190,000. In the street fund, there's a beginning fund balance of approximately $3.5 million, additional revenue of $2.1 million, expenses of $1.9 million, a capital transfer of almost $3 million for a total fund balance of $825,000. This is a very full list. happy to see it happening, and I'm sure as many other people are as well, but these are the capital projects that are supported by the street fund. There will be a server replacement, Glen Heather Street and Place Road rehab, which is a carryover from this year, Glendale Street rehab, which is a $1.1 million project, paving Forest Avenue, which is the one that's partially funded by the CDOT grant, in total $1.7 million, potential purchase of a water truck for dust control of $175,000, building an ice slicer bin up at Public Works for $120,000, and Carbondale right-of-way and sidewalk extension out to Forest Avenue for $75,000, and the Grandview Boulevard design and construction first of 2 years, reimbursed by the URAD for $1.7 million. The debt appropriations from the street fund are the public works trucks and the 2014 series geo bond payment of $190,000. And the capital fund beginning fund balance of $102,000, revenue of about $350,000, grant revenue of $800,000, capital transfers from the street and water fund for almost $5.7 million, and the expenses coming out of the capital fund for capital projects listed there below for a fund balance at the end of 2023 of $110,000. Conservation Trust Fund and the Impact Fee Fund are special revenue funds. They are their own funds. Because the funds are restricted, will maintain their own capital projects. These are the flagpole at Centennial Field, which is a carryover from this year. remote lights at Centennial Field. It's an update to our current lighting out there for $20,000 and a small BMX track improvement of $5,000. Beginning fund balance is $71,000. Revenue, which is pretty stable year over year, $38,000. Expenses totaling $85,000 for a fund balance of about $24,000. And finally, the impact fee fund summary. Beginning fund balance, $2.8 million. Additional revenue from those new home starts and building permits, about $845,000. The ARPA grant funds of $800,000. The expenses totaling $2.4 million for an ending fund balance of $2.1 million. And those capital projects are paving York Street and starting the city center master planning. The next item up for discussion is personnel costs. So with this budget, council will be approving a newly designed compensation plan to replace our three-year-old plan. This project started in August, and we created new job descriptions and updated current job descriptions to make sure that we were capturing all of the most current duties for each of the positions. And we did that by using help from Employers Council. Then we hired a highly reputable HR consulting firm, Graves Consulting, to conduct the research and lead development. We held meetings with department heads, staff, and council throughout the process, and held the final presentation at a work session on November 1st. The compensation plan provided adheres to the city's core compensation philosophy, which is the city recognizes that employees are critical to the success of our organization. We must attract and retain competent, professional, and results-oriented staff. Therefore, our total compensation program matches within our ability to pay other governmental and private employers. This includes competitive pay, benefits, contributions, and achievements that demonstrate concern for the well-being of our citizens. We believe in fostering employee teamwork, creativity, and innovation, and expect employees to continually strive to learn as well as apply problem-solving and collaboration skills in support of public service. So the compensation plan went on to revise both the open range general government pay structure and the non-exempt sworn police officer step plans. In the open range plan, each position was assigned a new pay range based on the criteria and data collected and their job descriptions. Then there was a recommended catch-up market adjustment for certain positions, based on years of service for similar experience, job duties, and certifications if applicable. And then 2023, we will see a cost of living adjustment of 2% effective January 1st, 2023. And at every employee's anniversary date, we are recommending a merit increase of up to 3% based on a job performance evaluation. For the police step plan, there was a decrease for both police officer and sergeant step plans from 7 to 6 steps, but there was an increase in steps from 5 to 6%. Market adjustments will happen at the current step effective January 1st, 2023, and then a step increase at anniversary date after performance evaluations, unless the position, the officer is already at the top step. The person who is assigned detective will also receive an additional annual equivalency of $3,000 for that assignment, and it will be split into equal pay period increments. Included in this budget also are several new and open positions. Council and staff have determined that the following positions are necessary to maintain effective service levels. Deputy clerk combined with a court clerk. The HR generalist combined with a finance technician and another police officer. We currently have 6 vacant positions to be filled. 2 maintenance workers, 2 police officers, a community relations and events coordinator, and an executive assistant. And those are all already included in the budget under the personnel costs. Another thing that was in the compensation plan was we took a look at benefits and compared them with others in the market. And currently, the city is fairly competitive with the level of benefits offered to employees. However, we did determine that it would be beneficial for the city to absorb the current health care increases for the plan that started November 1st and will go to October 31st, 2023. Dental increases, however, were shared between the city and the employees, and all other premiums remain stable. But in 2023, we will offer Colorado Healthy Families and Workers Act, otherwise known as HFWA. It's a pool of 48 hours of additional sick leave on top of current PTO accrual rates. And then finally, council did opt out of the Colorado Family Plan, but we are going to create a similar plan in-house that will become effective at the same time family will in January 2024. And finally, just to round things out on a fun note, we have all of our special events listed here that are all included in the budget. The Citywide Cleanout Month, Citywide Garage Sale, Almost Free Building Permit Month, Summer Splash, Music and Movies Summer Series, the Dacono Music and Spirits Festival, National Night Out, Veterans Wall of Honor Ceremony, and the Carbon Valley Holiday Festival. Council and staff created a budget that maintains essential services, builds infrastructure, improves workflow, and sets the city up for future expansion. While there will be some reserve spending in the year to come, the results will benefit everyone who lives, works, and visits this little city. We fully anticipate the investment is worth the product it will bring. The city invites all citizens and business owners to stay informed on current city news and updates by attending regular council meetings and reading posts on the city's website, Facebook, and Twitter. And staff does recommend approval of this budget. Any questions?
I don't think so. Any public comment regarding the 2023 budget? Seeing none. You move slow. Didn't know you're coming. You'll have to get sworn in again, I think.
Mary and address, please. Marion Thompson, 445 Hass Court, Dacono 80514.
Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give before the Dacona City Council will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. I'm back. Last time tonight. thank you all for listening to my requests. I do want to express a heartfelt thank you for earnestly listening to our requests and our concerns. So I know that you are voting on approval of this budget tonight. My concern regarding the budget is it was hard to access. I had to Quora it, and I did receive it, but it would be nice if it was on the website. And I heard Ms. Stroh say that it was at the Times Call newspaper?
It was published. The notice was published.
The notice for the hearing was published?
The notice for the public hearing was published.
Was published. Okay, I understand. So where as citizens can we find the budget prior to this meeting? Is there a way for us to do that?
I would again ask you to talk to AJ about that, because he can point you to where that should be, and maybe we can make that clearer in the future.
Maybe on the website?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, because the city runs that.
I mean, I can make it clear right now.
Okay.
It's a working budget, and it's not finally approved until hopefully tonight. So that's why we have work sessions that are open to the public. And it's open for inspection in our clerk's office as well.
Okay. So we are asking that the city of Dacono be transparent. And that seems like it's not transparent to me, AJ, because if I'm a citizen and I want to take a look at it, am I going to be able to take time out of my day if there's a meeting? I mean, if you want us to know, make it accessible. And of course, post, this is a working document. This is not set in stone until it's approved by city council.
AJ, I'm sorry. Wasn't the budget in the packet that was published on the city's website for this meeting tonight also?
Yeah, it's in the packet. And then we present the draft budget that's also in a packet.
So if I can connect with you, it would be great if you could show me that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I was unable to find it. Myself and three other people were unable to find it.
Yeah, I'll be happy. And okay. And if you, I would just ask a general, because we hear comments at meetings and public hearings about, I can't find something on the website or a link is broken. I know even a council member brought it up. Gosh, if you could let staff know, I mean, we're in the office all day, every day. We'd be happy to help guide you through the website.
Okay.
If some link's broken, fix it up. So I just want to, you don't have to come and take time out of your day. I know you're busy and say a link's broken or I can't find it.
Mm-hmm.
Send us an email, call, anything you want. And we're happy to help you access that information that's out there.
Fantastic. Sure. Thank you. Okay. I think Ms. Stroh might have a little wiggle room in the budget for Sixth Street. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Any questions from council? Hearing none, I'll close the public hearing on the 2023 budget and give it to council for deliberations and or a motion.
I move to approve Resolution 22-91, adopting a budget for 2023 and approving a summary of revenues and expenditures.
I second.
Can I get a vote, please, Val?
Jim Tirini.
Yes.
Jackie Thomas.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Catherine Whitman.
Yes.
Thank you. Resolution 2291 passes with all council voting yes. We're now on to Resolution 2292.
I move to approve Resolution 2292, approving funds for 2023.
I second.
Get a vote, please, Val.
Jackie Thomas.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Catherine Whitman.
Yes.
Jim Tirini.
Yes.
Resolution 2292 passes with all council voting yes. We're now on a motion 2293.
I move to approve Resolution 22-93, adopting a pay plan for city employees.
I'll second.
Can you vote, please, Val?
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Catherine Whitman.
Yes.
Jim Tirini.
Yes.
Jackie Thomas.
Yes.
Resolution 2293 passes with all council voting yes. So now we are on to appointment of Mayor Pro Tem.
I move to approve to appoint Jackie Thomas, if she's willing to accept it as Mayor Pro Tem.
No, I would not.
Okay.
Thank you, though. I make a motion to make Kathy Whitman Mayor Pro Tem. Continue in that role.
I would second that.
Okay. Can I get a vote, please?
Doris Crespo?
Yes.
Catherine Whitman?
Yes.
Jim Tirini?
Yes.
Jackie Thomas?
Yes.
Kevin Plain?
Yes.
Okay, congratulations.
Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem Whitman, on your next year of service. So we're on to staff reports. AJ.
Thank you, Mayor. First, I'd like to thank Kelly and the rest of staff for all the hard work they put in on the budget. It's this year with all the projects and moving pieces and just refining it. Was a heavy lift. And I'd also like to thank all of you for allowing us to do all these projects and improve the resident experience and businesses as well. And all the work sessions we've had more than our fair share this last quarter. So thank you all very much for approving the budget. We really appreciate it on behalf of all staff. Quickly, I'll just run through. We have our Carbon Valley Holiday Festival this Saturday out in the parking area. Front of City Hall from 4 to 6 with the tree lighting. In a minute, I'll turn it over to Jennifer. She has some neat information on that. And then on December 7th, so next Wednesday, we have our Urban Renewal Authority meeting, and that's our 2023 budget adoption. And then we have a city council meeting on December 12th. And then that will likely be our last meeting of the year on December 12th.
Okay. A lot of departments. Anything for you guys?
Excuse me. Mayor and Council, as AJ mentioned, the holiday festival is this Saturday from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. As always, we could use volunteers for assisting with the food donation and ornament giveaway. There are opportunities to assist with the chili supper portion of the event. And to help us organize the carriage rides, which are always very popular. This year, I'm very excited that volunteers will receive an embroidered scarf. So if you're able to volunteer, we have a scarf waiting for you as an additional incentive. Please email me if you are available, again, because we could use help for this event. Thank you.
Jennifer, could you repeat those areas of the email?
Sure. So 1 hour shifts with the ornament tent. There are opportunities with the chili tent to serve chili, and we need some assistance with the carriage rides. These are 1 to 2 hour volunteer slots. Just let me know if you're available.
So I just want to understand that when we do the ornaments for the people that are donating the food.
Right. The ornaments are a fundraiser for the Carbon Valley Help Center. We ask for a $5 donation or equivalent food donation.
Okay. Okay. And then, okay, good. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Jen. Any other staff reports? It's quiet. We got it done quick tonight. I was thinking 8 o'clock. Any council reports?
No.
I mean, I'll see you all.
Thank you all.
I would just like to say I would like to see the city find a little wiggle room to do 6th Avenue too.
Yeah. We've talked about that. Yeah, so we'll have to we'll hopefully address that when we can. So I know I feel the same way. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Meeting adjourned.
Thank you.